Professor Dave again, let's take a look at oxidative phosphorylation.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
We've examined the first two steps of cellular respiration. These are glycolysis and the citric acid cycle. As it turns out, neither process generates much of an energy payoff, but the NADH and FADH2 that were generated in the citric acid cycle move on to oxidative phosphorylation, which generates by far the most ATP out of these pathways. This pathway utilizes an electron transport chain, which is a series of mitochondrial membrane proteins that sit in the inner membrane of the mitochondrion, and we refer to these as protein complexes 1 through 4. These proteins bear a variety of prosthetic groups, which are non-protein components that give the protein its functionality, including flavin mononucleotides and cytochromes. There is also one compound in the electron transport chain that is not a protein, and that's ubiquinone, a small hydrophobic molecule that is mobile within the membrane, and it is also known as coenzyme Q, or CoQ. Once NADH feeds electrons into the first component of complex 1, these proteins facilitate a series of redox reactions, shuttling the electrons downhill from one component to another, with each structure down the chain having a higher affinity for electrons than the last. This process does not generate ATP directly, but a byproduct of this series of electron transfers is the generation of a proton gradient across the membrane. Protons accumulate outside of the inner mitochondrial membrane, which then go to power another protein complex called ATP synthase. As you might guess from the name, this is the component that synthesizes ATP. Because the proton concentration becomes greater in the intermembrane space than inside the mitochondrial matrix, the protons will spontaneously move with the gradient to re-enter the mitochondrial matrix, and the only route available is through ATP synthase. This process is called chemiosmosis, and because the gradient is able to do work through chemiosmosis, we also call this the proton-motive force. And it is these protons that power ATP synthase in phosphorylating ADP to generate ATP. ATP synthase has a fascinating structure with a component that looks startlingly like a rotor, where individual protons can bind and cause it to spin in such a way that catalyzes phosphorylation of ADP, kind of like a stream of water turning a water wheel, which can then power some other process. With the NADH and FADH2 that is generated from a single molecule of glucose, we can get around 26 or 28 ATPs from this activity. So this is the pathway that generates the majority of cellular energy. So in summary, your body uses a variety of metabolic pathways. Glycolysis, the most ancient, produces 2 ATPs per glucose. But it also results in pyruvate, which can enter the citric acid cycle. Here, those 2 pyruvates generate another 2 ATP, but they also generate 6 NADH and 2 FADH2 molecules that can go on to the electron transport chain, which gives us our big ATP payout. Feel free to use this summary of the 3 steps in cellular respiration if you need to remember the main points of each process, all starting with just 1 molecule of glucose. Other sources of food, like proteins, fats, and other carbohydrates besides glucose, are initially broken down in unique ways, but this will always result in some compound that is eventually fed into one of the pathways we discussed. So all the food we eat eventually gets broken down this way. This is why mitochondria are regarded as the engine of the cell, since most of the energy needed for cellular activity comes from them. So the next time you're walking home and you feel tired, just think of all those trillions of enzymes slaving away to help you move your feet. It might put a little pep in your step. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.